Now, what Peter is talking about here is how that the church should carry themselves in the end times. How that you and I, as children of God, should be seen by the world. How that our lives should be characterized. How that our walk should be seen. How that our salt should permeate the world. How that our light should go forth unto the world to show them the gospel of Jesus Christ. See, what Peter is talking about here, he is saying, listen, church, in light of His coming and in light of the persecution that you're facing, church, you need to be about the Father's business. You need to be carrying through with the things He is saying that you need to be doing. Now, Peter is saying something. He is saying to you and I as children of God that we've got just a few days. How many believe that tonight?
Amen.
People will say, Brother Rudy, I've heard that all my life. I'm 52 years old. I know I look a lot younger. Amen. You're supposed to say amen to that. Listen, I want to tell you what Peter is saying, though. He is saying, listen, the coming of the Lord is nigh. He is soon at the door. The Bible says when you see these things that we're about to talk about, when you see them, you need to lift up your eyes and lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh. As children of God, we've heard that all our lives. I was saved at 8 years old at a young age, and God came into my life, and I've been in church all of my life. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, every day or night of revival. My mom and dad took me, and they raised me up in the house of God. Beloved, I want to tell you, I knew and I studied the Word of God with all of my heart, and I heard that through the ages, preach and say, God's coming back. He's coming back. But church, I want to tell you something. You and I are the first generation where everything I believe with all my heart has been fulfilled in the Word of God. That could not have been said when I was a child. It could not have been said. There was things that were unfulfilled. There was things that were about to be seen. We're going to see some of those tonight. Now, Peter is saying, listen, there's scoffers out there, and I want to read from 2 Peter. And the Bible says in 2 Peter some things that are important for us to understand, important for us to see. In 2 Peter, the Bible teaches us that, listen, God is saying that you need to open your eyes, and that in the latter days there's going to be scoffers that's going to come between you. And they're going to say, where is the promise of His coming? And then 2 Peter goes on in chapter 3 and says that as children of God, we need to understand that, listen, as they said, that it's been that way since day one, since the very creation of time, how it's not changed. And Peter is saying, listen, some of you have died. Some of you have went home to glory. You need to understand that is part of the Scripture. The Bible says that after death comes the judgment of the Lord. Notice what it says. Now notice this in verse 7, but. I like that word. That word but. You know, it's a conjective participle. And what it is meaning is it joins the next verse with the preceding verse that is there, which is verse 6. For this cause was the gospel preached unto you that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. What he is saying is some have died. Some have went on to glory, but they lived their life. And those that are alive seen the light that they left and the testimony that they left and the characteristics that they left, and they were blessed by it. Beloved, as children of God, that is what you and I have to do. We have to live our lives as if the coming of the Lord was right now. Amen? And the Bible says, why do we need to do that? Well, if you would notice, the Bible tells us something here. It says in verse 5, who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead? Listen, he may tarry his coming. He may tarry those things, but there's coming a day when God will judge both the living and the dead, both the saved and the unsaved. Saved, the Bible says. You and I, as children of God, are going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and we're going to be given rewards for that. We're not going to be judged for our salvation. Can you say, thank God? Listen, thank the Lord my sins that went before. Thank the Lord that, thank God, God has saved me, and one of these days I'm going to get to see Him. But you and I are going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ to be judged for those things which we did or didn't do, and the Bible says we're going to either be rewarded or not rewarded. Amen. I want the reward of God, don't you? I want to be able to cast any crown I get at the feet of Jesus, amen? I want to be able to do that. But the Bible says that they that are lost are going to appear at the judge. Listen, they're going to appear at the great white throne of God, and they're going to be judged for the works which they have done. Beloved, I'm not going to be judged in my salvation for the works which I have done. Can you say amen? Thank God they're found in Christ. Thank God that I rest in the Lord. Thank God that everything is right between me and the Lord because of His grace and His mercy. But beloved, the Bible says there's coming a judgment day. Can you say amen to that? There's coming a judgment day when, listen, the lost will be judged by God. And the Bible said, listen, if he tarries, he's coming. You need to understand that judgment delayed does not mean that judgment is not coming. It is coming to everyone that is here, beloved. And I want to tell you tonight, as children of God, well, because of that, and because that we'll face the Lord, and because that we will appear before God one day, that you and I, as children of God, should live our lives unto the Lord. Amen. And the Peter said, listen, you can know what to say. You can know those things. St. Peter said this, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. Listen, judgment delayed does not mean that judgment is not coming. It is coming, church. It is coming for each. And I want to be ready for him. I want to be doing the things that he would have to us to do. Now, understand, the Bible says that because that God is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, that he's going to delay his coming as long as he can. But there's going to be a day when he says, son, go get your bride. Amen. There's going to be a day when time will be no more. And God said that I'm coming back to receive you unto myself. Listen, he ascended up into heaven in Acts chapter 1. And the angels appeared before the disciples there. And he said, in like manner, so shall he come. Amen. I'm glad that we're going to see him come in the clouds. And we'll go to meet him in the air. Amen. Amen. Look to your neighbor and say, praise the Lord. There's coming a day when I'm going to be with the Lord. Amen. There's going to be coming a day when we will be clothed. The Bible says the righteousness of the saints. We're going to be with him and enjoy him in glory. But beloved, that day is not right now. I've got a little more time. I've got a little more things that I need to do before the coming of the Lord. I want you to turn with me, if you would, to Luke chapter 17. And I want us to talk about the coming of the Lord. Listen, we don't set days and we don't set times. The Lord said not to do that. But beloved, you and I can look at the signs of our times as God said for us to do, and we can determine whether his coming is nigh or not. And I want us to look at that for just a moment. In Luke, the Bible says in chapter 17, of the book of Luke. I wasn't going to turn there, but I want you to turn there. When you find it, say amen. Amen. Well, I hadn't found it yet, and I can't say amen yet. But Luke chapter 17, and I believe verse, I want you to just go with me to verse 26. 17 and verse 26. And I've got one more page, and I'm going to get there. In verse 26, it says, as was in the days of Noah, so shall it also be in the days of the Son of Man. Yeah. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they brought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man, the Bible says, is revealed. Beloved, the Bible says, as in the days of Noah, as in the days of Lot. Now what was it? Listen. As in the days of Noah. Noah preached for 120 years. The people did not listen to him. They thought, listen, these are extremists. This Noah, he's crazy. But beloved, God sent Noah. And God said, this is the way it's going to happen. Noah, and Noah trusted God. And it happened exactly like Noah said. So shall it be in the coming of the days of the Lord. There's preachers going up and down this countryside. And they're preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're saying, the Lord is coming, get ready. The Lord is coming, get prepared. Be about his business. Church, stay busy with the things of God. Beloved, there's going to be people that are scoffers. They're going to look at you. They're going to say you're an extremist. They're going to say you're right wing. They're going to say, listen, I don't want to hear it. But beloved, as God said it is, so shall it be. They went out unprepared. They went to hell without God. And beloved, there are going to be those today that they're going to go out unprepared, and they're going to go out without God on their side. Beloved, I want to tell you something today. We need to understand that judgment delayed does not mean that judgment is not not coming, because it is coming. As in the days of Noah, as in the days of Lot, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of God. Beloved, I won't ask you to return there, but in Matthew chapter 24, and you know Matthew 24 is simply a parallel of Revelation, amen? Now stay with me. Oh, stay with me. Don't be thinking about what you're going to do at night or tonight when you get home. I want you to stay with me. In Matthew 24 and 33, the Bible tells us something there that is interesting. It says this, "So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near." What is near? The coming of the Lord. It is even at the door. Lord, I want to tell you something. When I go up to your door of your house and I knock on your door, I'm ready to come in. If you'll open the door, I'll come in. I want to tell you something. You're not the one that's going to open the door. God Himself is going to open the door. And Jesus is at the door. He's ready to come in when you see these things come to pass. When these signs come to pass that God has planted in the Word of God, you're going to see it. Now again, in Matthew chapter 24, again, that chapter is a parallel of the book of Revelation. And as you read it, you find out how that Revelation is going to unfold. And as you find out how Revelation is going to unfold, you need to understand what God is saying. God is saying, "I've given you signs, church, that you can be prepared for your coming," amen, "for the coming of the Lord." Oh, you can't date it. You can't put a time on it, Brother Tommy. You can't do that. But, beloved, I want to tell you something. We can know that He's soon coming, amen. I feel it in my heart. I feel it with all of my heart that He's soon coming, church. And Brother Jeff, I'm looking forward for His coming, amen. Praise God, He's coming soon, as the Bible says. And, beloved, I want to tell you, they could have said it 60 years ago, and, beloved, it couldn't come to pass. There was too much that could not be fulfilled, had not been fulfilled. You are the first generation where all is fulfilled in the Word of God. He's soon coming, church. We need to be about His business. And that is what God is saying here, that you and I, as children of God, need to do those things. Now, I want us to go back, just spend a few moments. There's 32 signs of His coming that in the last 60 years have been fulfilled, amen? That's been fulfilled in our time. Listen, signs of His coming that pretends and tells us that God is coming and this is a sign that will be in the world at the time of His coming. You want to turn with me to Daniel chapter 4, or Daniel chapter 2 first. I want to look at that, and then we'll go to 4. Beloved, I want to tell you something that is happening. Now, Nebuchadnezzar had a vision, okay? King Nebuchadnezzar, you know the story. I don't have time to go into it. You can study it later. But he had a vision of a man. And that man stood before him with a head of gold and silver around the breast area. And then it went into bronze and then into iron and clay at the feet. And oh, it troubled him. And he asked all of his smart men, great men. He said, "Listen, interpret this dream." And they could not. They could not. But we know the story how that God gave Daniel the interpretation, and he told the king, "This is the interpretation of this man." Do you remember the story? Now listen, that story of that man is history to us. It was all future to Daniel and to Nebuchadnezzar. It teaches us the ages that is to come. All right, and in those ages, Daniel said to the king, he said, "O king, you saw a man. And that man had a head of gold. That is you, Nebuchadnezzar. That was the Babylon kingdom." Now, this is good stuff to study. I'm not going to spend much time on it so you can say amen. Whew, oh, that's good. But listen, he went on further and said, "There's going to be a lesser kingdom come after you, Nebuchadnezzar, the Medo-Persian Empire." We read of Belteshazzar and others that were there in that empire. And you remember it, the empire that Persia had. And beloved, that's a lesser kingdom. It's a kingdom of Sivir. And, O king, there's a third kingdom that's coming after that second kingdom that's even lesser than the second one, and that is the Bronze Kingdom. And you remember Alexander the Great and the Grecian kingdom, and all what stories are behind that, and how the prophecy of Scripture of the Old Testament was given to Alexander the Great, and he did not destroy Jerusalem because he was found and he saw himself in the Old Testament Scripture. There's wonderful things about that. My goodness, that'll preach and teach. But, beloved, I want to tell you something. That was the kingdom, the third kingdom. And he said, "O king, it's going to go into the fourth kingdom." You remember how Alexander the Great had two generals? It broke into the two sides. And he said, "That's the legs. That's even a lesser kingdom." And then the last kingdom is the kingdom of the feet. Amen. And beloved, you and I, we live in that time. Can you say amen? Say, Brother Rudy, I don't know a lot about that. Well, you need to ask the few in this church that does, amen? Because it's fun stuff. And it's interesting, amen? And it tells about the goodness of the Lord. Now, if God could prophesy that, He could prophesy anything, amen? And it'll come true, amen? All the promises of God are yea in Him, and in Him, amen. Can you say amen to that? Listen, that is what God is saying. Listen, you and I are at the last kingdom. And when did it start? In 476 A.D. is when it started. And it broke into the Roman Empire. And listen, there became the 10 toes of clay and of iron mixed together. Nothing solid, nothing there. And beloved, that kingdom has been coming since this time. You say, Brother Rudy, what has that got to do with the end times? Just this right here. Look at chapter 2 and verse 29. The last part of it says, the great God hath made known to the king what should come to pass hereafter. Listen, that is historical evidence. But we're not finished with the story yet. I've got to hurry. You listen to me. We've only got about 3 more hours in the sermon, so perk up. Amen. Listen, what God is saying, there's something else here. He is saying then, in the verses following that, that there's a straight God. When you see this last kingdom, the kingdom of the toes come on to play, understand, that's the last kingdom. That's the last kingdom. There's going to be a great stone come out of that mountain, Brother Jeff, and it's going to come down, and it's going to break all the kingdoms into pieces, and it will become the true kingdom. Beloved, I want to tell you, that's great stone, 1 Corinthians says, is Jesus Christ our Lord. Praise God for that. I'm glad that He's coming down out of that kingdom, and He takes control, amen? I'm glad of that. Beloved, I'm going to tell you something. That is historical evidence. We're living in the last days. In May 1948, there's some other historical evidence. Do you remember what happened? Israel became a nation again. Amen? The Bible said in Isaiah that it would be a nation in one day. One day, a nation would be born overnight, meaning the nation of Israel. And the Bible, and listen, history tells us that. Harry Truman, he signed the note. Thank God America was the one that done it. But he signed it, and Israel became a sovereign nation in May 1948. Beloved, you know what the Bible says about that? It says that this generation that's seen that will not pass away. Amen. Until the coming of the Lord. Amen, amen, brother. Amen. There's 20 years, about 19 years now left in this generation. He's got to come within 18 years or we're not understanding Scripture or He didn't fulfill prophecy one. I believe we understand it clearly. And I believe that in the next few months, next few days, He's coming. He's coming whether you win your people to the Lord or not. He's coming whether you're busy doing His business or not, church. He's coming. Judgment delayed does not mean that judgment will not come. He's coming again, the Bible says. Beloved, what about the third thing? We can talk about Israel, and there's all kinds of Scripture. But we're not going to go through the 32, but we're going to go through a few. What about the increase of knowledge? In Daniel chapter 12, would you like to turn there? In Daniel chapter 12 and verse 4, it talks about something. It talks about the time of the end. Notice what it says. When you get there, say, praise the Lord. If you're not there, just look intelligent where you're at. You'll be all right. In chapter 12 and verse 4, it says, even to the time of the end, last part of that verse, many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased.
Yeah.
Knowledge.
Amen.
Did you know that throughout history, from the time of creation, there's been a little or no increase in knowledge? Up until the last few years?
Yeah.
Understand that. How long ago has it been since we stopped riding horses and we started riding cars? Did you know the first car? It moved at an astounding speed of 8 miles per hour. Wow! The medical doctors of that day said that speed for a long duration of time has got to be too much and it's hard on the body. And they begin to study the body to see if 8 miles per hour hurt the body. That's true. We go tens of thousands of miles today when they go into space. Did you know that from creation of time until 1700s was one unit of knowledge? Now, brother, listen. Sister, listen. This matters. Don't get bored. I hope you don't just say, hey, I didn't come for this. Yeah, you did. You're here for a purpose.
Amen.
I don't like preaching this the more than you do, but I've got to preach it. Amen. It's what God laid on my heart. Beloved, from creation of the 1700s, they say that's one unit of knowledge. That's how much we increased, one unit of knowledge. Listen, from the 1700s to 1890, they say that knowledge doubled. One plus one unit of knowledge is two units of knowledge. Amen? Say with me, two units of knowledge. So it took from creation to the 1700s to get one unit of knowledge. It took from the 1700s to 1890 to get 2 units of knowledge. From 1890 to 1930, it doubled again. 2 + 2 = what? 4. All right, 4, at least where I went to school. That's 4 units of knowledge in that many years. Listen, from 1930 to 1950, it doubled again. 4 + 4 = what? 8 units of knowledge. Do you know how it's doubling today? You know what length of time? It's not 10 years. It's not even 2 years. In every 18 months in our day and time, knowledge is doubling. I'm talking going from 8 to 8 is 16. 16 to 16 is 32. 32 to 32 is 64. It is doubling, church. Listen, a sign of the time is the knowledge increaseth in the day that we live. In every area of study, knowledge has increased exponentially. Beloved, what God is saying here, that listen, church, when you see knowledge increasing, when you see it going up and up, I'm at the door, amen? I'm fixing to come through. Can you say praise the Lord? The Bible tells us that another sign of the time is sexual immorality, not just in America, but in every nation. And we're seeing that today that is here. We're seeing an increase in violence. We're seeing an increase in sexual immorality. Remember what Matthew 24:37 says? But as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. Listen, how was it in the days of Noah? The Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 6 that the earth was filled with violence. Amen? Genesis chapter 6 says that in Noah's day, the earth was filled with violence. Many of you saw the tragedy of the Marines getting killed in Chattanooga. My daughter is a nurse, and she was in the midst of that, in the midst of that trouble and that chaos that was over there. And she called me and she says, Daddy, I'm at Erlanger. They've got us locked down. Listen, she said, I can't go anywhere, and people are dying. They brought in some Marines that have been shot. Daddy, what's going on? Beloved, I want to tell you something. We live in a time of violence. It isn't every month that we hear this. It isn't every week we hear this. It's every day that we hear this, church. Can you say amen to that? Amen. We live in the day. Listen, the Bible says it's in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. This is worldwide. It's not just in America. You hear of it. Oh, listen, the persecuted church says there's more Christians killed today than there ever have been in the history of mankind. Beloved, I want to tell you, as children of God, we need to be about His business, church. We need to understand we don't have a lot of time. The Bible tells us, also in Luke 17, it says, as in the days of Lot. Now, how is it in the days of Lot? The Bible says in the book of Jude, chapter 1 and verse 7, it tells us that in the days of Lot, that they went after strange flesh. Well, you know what that is, don't you? That's homosexuality. That's, I can preach on that in this church, can't I? In other words, can I preach against that in this church? But I want to tell you something. The Bible says, and as in the days of Lot, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man. Did you know that there are 16 nations in the world right here today, industrialized nations, that's okayed same-sex marriage. They've okayed homosexuality. They're not just saying it's okay. They're promoting it. Beloved, we are not leading it, thank God, but we're in the midst of it, and we're doing the same thing. People got all mad about the Supreme Court and said they didn't have the right, and they didn't. But listen, 26 states had already okayed same-sex marriage. They were just joining the crowd. Don't you join the crowd, church. Amen. You don't have to be politically correct. Amen. You don't have to stay on the sidelines and let all of this happen. You can be a force for God, and you can move those around you. Amen? Homosexuality is wrong. We love the sinner, but we hate the sin. Amen. We put up with the sinner and love them with all of our hearts and accept them, but we hate their sin. We'll not condone their sin. We'll not let their sin in our midst. That's what the Bible is saying. The Bible said in Jude chapter 1 and verse 7 that, listen, they're going to go after strange flesh and they're going to go after fornication. Amen? That's exactly what's happening in our day. Amen. Beloved, people are leaving the churches by droves. Pastors are leaving with somebody other than their wife. Listen, women are leaving with someone other than themselves. Why? Because God said, listen, it's going to happen in the last days. It's going to prevail in the last days. Amen. He's coming, church. Amen. I can't go on. There's 30. There's 32 signs of the times. I've showed you enough. There's another sign that says that His appearing, every eye shall see Him. That could not happen 50 years ago, church. There wasn't that capability. There wasn't the ability for the world to see it. Beloved, I want to tell you something. Listen, I've got a friend in Haiti, and he's got a phone, a smartphone, amen. They bought him one. He's got a smartphone. The other day, a few months ago, he took a picture in Haiti. And as soon as he took that picture, he sent it to me. Beloved, I'm going to tell you something. It is, listen, a half a second delay now, and you can see exactly what's going on. Amen? That could not be true 50 years ago. Amen. Beloved, we could go on and on and on. World missions. You know the Bible said in one place that the gospel is going to be preached to the world, Matthew 24:14. Remember what it said? It said the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all nations, and then will I come. In November of last year, World Mission said, the gospel has been preached to all nations. Across the airwaves, every tribe has heard them. Across the airwaves. It doesn't mean every person has, but it is fulfilled the way Scripture is written. Church, He's coming. Are you ready to meet Him? Is your people saved? Peter said there's three things that are to characterize the church. Go back with me and we'll now preach the message. Can you say amen? Amen. Just look to your neighbor and say he's about to get on the message now. Yeah. Beloved, the Bible says here that Peter said there's three things that should characterize us. He said number one is love, number two is prayer, and number three is service to the church. But there is something, he said in verse 11, that characterizes or overrides the overriding principle of all of it. Beloved, a lot of times we'll say this. We'll say, listen, the church exists to win souls. Beloved, it does. But that is not our overriding principle. People will say, Brother Rudy, the church is there to fulfill the gospel mission, which is to teach and save and baptize and then teach and make a circle for them to go around. Uh-uh. That is not the overriding principle. Church, the overriding principle for you and I is for you and I to bring glory to God, period. That is what we're here for. Amen. That is exactly what Peter said here in verse 11. I want you to notice what he said here in verse 11. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as the ability which God giveth. Listen to this. That God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now don't you cut me off. I know we're to be about the Father's business and win souls. I know that that is our business. But listen, everything we do. Listen, Sunday school teacher, your job when you stand in your Sunday school class is not just to win souls. It is to bring glory to God. And in bringing the glory to God, you'll win souls. And you'll teach the Word the way it should be. And you'll live your life the way God wants you to live it. See, what I'm saying is this, your principle, the overriding thing of your entire Christian life is to glorify God. That's why Jesus came, is to bring glory to the Father. And that's why you and I are here. Listen, church, you and I need to bring glory to the Father. Now, what does it mean to glorify the Father? See, that's the catch, isn't it? I've got a lady in our church. She's a deacon's wife. And I've got to hurry, but she loves to take pictures and she's good at it. I live next to the Sequatchie Valley. If you've ever been through there, it's one of the prettiest places in the world, I think. And I'm prejudiced. It's okay. But you go through Raven's Rock, and you can see the valley up and down it. Especially this time of year with all the fall colors, it's beautiful. She took a picture, and she's good at taking pictures. And it's one of those panorama pictures. You know, it just reaches out and it curves. It's beautiful. But when she showed me that, I didn't look to her and said, "Shirley, I admire you." I said, "Oh my goodness, you're such a photographer." I didn't say that at all. You see, I've seen the Sequatchie Valley many times with my own eyes, grew up there, went down that mountain, up that mountain 1,000 times. But when I saw that picture, I said, "Sister Shirley, that's just like you're there." See, the purpose of the picture is to glorify the scene. Amen. The purpose that you and I are here, to put it in street language, plain language, you and I, children of God, is to make God look as good as He is. That's why we're here, church. I didn't extol the photographer. I extolled the picture. I lifted it up and I said, "My goodness, this is just like the real thing." You're to be like the real thing. You're to be Him, church. You're to glorify Him, lift Him up, love Him. Let others see what He would do in the situation. You know why that you're a Christian businessman? You're to show the world how a Christian businessman needs to act and react out there. You know why God made you a teacher of the schools? To show those children what it is for a Christian to teach school. To show them what God is and how God reacts in that school. Mom and Dad, you know why that God gave you children? To show them what God is like in your marriage and in your relationship. Buddy, that'll keep you from fussing and putting little things ahead of your husband and ahead of your wife. Amen?
Amen.
Beloved, as God is saying, that's why we're here, church. Our overriding principle is to bring glory to the Father, to bring glory to the Son, to allow the Holy Spirit to live within us. We are in the last days, church. And oh, in our reactions and our actions to everyday life, we need to be Jesus. We need to be just like Him, church. Listen, we talk about winning souls in revival. Revival's for you. It's for you to get your heart right. It's for you to get the house clean, every door open, and God coming into every room of your heart. And when He's like that and He's in every house, in every room, this church is going to glorify the Father. It is going to be lifted up in the community, and souls will be saved. Not people saved that as soon as a pastor changes or as soon as somebody gets mad, they leave, but souls that will stay and they'll work for the kingdom of God in the church that God has placed them at.
Amen.
That is what God wants. That is what God wants in your life, in my life. The overriding principle here, Peter said, in light of His coming, His soon coming, is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
To make Him look as good as He is. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, you talking about a load on you. If my wife wasn't here, I'd say, well, maybe I characterize that a little bit. But she's here. And oh, I have trouble. And so do you. But church, we're overcomers. Amen? We've been made to fight heavenly battles and made to win heavenly battles.
Amen.
And we can do it through Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
Let's talk about what God is saying. Now listen, there's 3 years of your life. And I'm going to do this quickly. So listen quick. Amen? Look to your neighbor and say, listen quick. Amen? Listen good. Our job is to glorify the Lord. How do we do that? Peter said in the last days, this is 3 things that you got to do. You've got to take authority in your life. Notice what he says. He said this, number one, that you and I as children of God, that we should glorify God through prayer. Through prayer. Notice what he says in verse 7. The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, because He's coming, this is the way you live, church. This is what you do. You and I, as children of God, need to live like God told us to live. We need to do what God told us to do. Why? So that in all things, verse 11, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom is the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Listen, you and I as children of God, number one, should glorify God through prayer. Did you see it?
Amen.
Did you see it? The Bible says, you be therefore sober and watch unto what? Unto, help me out now, unto prayer.
Yeah.
Unto prayer. I've got a next door neighbor. He's got a lot of sheep. Do you know you're a sheep?
Yeah.
Yeah. Say it, I'm a sheep. You know, sheep are dirty, stinky, dumb animals. I'm not going to ask you to say I'm a dirty, stinky, dumb animal. You're a sheep. And that's what sheep are. They need a leader. Sometimes they need a little sheepdog. Have you ever seen a little sheepdog run the sheep? Gather the sheep? Lead the sheep? Well, Bobby's my next door neighbor, and he's got a, I think he sold him, but he had a bunch of sheep, and one day I stopped. He had his little dog out there, his little sheep dog, and my goodness, that thing was trained. It was so good. And I watched it from the vehicle for a few minutes, and I got out. I said, I have got to see this up front and see what he's doing. Because Bobby wasn't doing nothing, and that sheep, I always looked to Bobby. It didn't matter if he was 200 yards away, he'd look to Bobby, and Bobby would make a little motion, or he'd do this, and he would do this right here. He just all kinds of motion, and that dog knew exactly what to do. That dog had been trained to follow its master. And when he'd done a task, I stood up and I said, Bobby, I said, what are you doing? He said, I've got signals, and he said, there's about 8, and he said, this is how I do it, and the dog knows exactly, and he's always watching me. And all of a sudden, that dog quit running those sheep, and he came up to Bobby, and he was like this at Bobby. And he was looking up, and he's going, and he's just quivering. He's just quivering. And I said, Bobby, I said, what's he doing? Bobby said, Rudy, he said, it's called at prayer. I said, what? I said, boy, that'll preach. That'll preach. Won't be many people do it, but that'll preach, amen. And he said, I said, Bobby, tell me again. I said, what's he doing? He said, sitting there with anticipation, quivering all over himself, that tongue hanging out, as happy a dog as I've ever seen in my life, looking at Bobby. And Bobby, all that Bobby had to do is do that. Boy, that dog went. And he went. I said, Bobby, what just happened? He said, Rudy, that's called at prayer. I said, at prayer? He said, yeah. He said, he's waiting for me to tell it what to do. Wow. Paul said to pray without ceasing. He said to pray always. And I said, oh my goodness, Lord, I know now. I've tried to explain that. I know now. Beloved, you and I, children of God, we pray and we say, God, I need this and I need that. And oh, Lord, I'm supplicating now, God, and I want you to bless this one and bless that one. Oh, God, I'm standing in prayer for them. And we do all of that and we just ask. That's not prayer. It's a little bitty portion of what God said to do. Prayer is listening. Listening, church. Peter said, listen, the Lord is coming back. You need to know what He needs you to know. And we're to sit there, Lord, what's next? What do you want me to do? I'm ready, Lord. Who do I need to visit? Where do I need to go? Do I need to call the pastor and uplift him today? Do I need to call my Sunday school teacher and just encourage him or her today? What do I need to do, Lord? I'm just waiting.
Amen.
That's it, church.
That's good.
Pray.
Bless it, Lord.
We think prayer is asking for things. No, prayer is doing things. It's listening and then going as God would tell us to go. We're to always be at prayer.
Amen.
Always waiting, anticipating, wanting to know the Father's will, church.
Amen.
That is what God has called us to do. We should glorify Him through prayer. You know what prayer is? Prayer is that little dog waiting for its master to tell it where to go. It is submitting itself to the Father's will. That is our job, church. That's why prayer is so important. That's why you have to take authority in your prayers. You have to put yourself last and say, oh God, you know my needs. Before I even ask Him, the Scripture says that. Lord, I need to know what Your will is today. I need to know where I need to go today. What I need. Did you ask Him this morning where you needed to go this morning?
Bless Him, Lord. Bless Him.
Did you ask Him when you got home, when you was about to turn that TV on, whether God wanted you to watch a TV show or to call somebody and invite them to revival? What was He asking you to do, church? I want revival, but are you willing to submit in prayer?
Blessed Lord.
I want revival, but are you willing to listen to the Father before you listen to self? That's revival. Revival is when you can submit and on your knees and say, God, I'm Yours today. I'm Yours today. And when we do that, we've glorified the Father.
Amen.
We brought glory to Him. Oh my goodness. But he goes on. Peter said, listen, there's something else you need to understand about prayer, that you and I, as children of God, we need to be of sound judgment. And then he said, be sober. You know what be sober means here in these verses? It simply means don't be drunk. Brother Rudy, I got that whip. Don't have a problem with alcohol no more. You better not have. Amen.
Bless the Lord.
But it means more than just not to be under the influence. It means to have clarity of mind. Remember what the Bible says? To be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be ye filled with the Spirit.
Amen.
See, the issue of drinking there was not even in the text. He wasn't talking about drinking, whether it's all right to drink a little bit or a lot. He was saying, don't be influenced by nothing but the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Let the Spirit be the one that controls you. Let the Spirit be the one that directs your life.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Be sober. Be of a sound mind. You know what we do? We get mad at each other and boy, we lose that soundness.
Amen.
We become drunk on our desire and we don't listen to the Father's desire, church.
Amen. That's true.
No, as children of God, we need to get to the place that we don't become offended at all. The Bible says, he that's in the law, he's in the Word of God. Nothing shall offend him. Nothing. Well, Brother Rudy, I'm not going to teach my class anymore. They said a few things, and I'm just not going to do it. Was you doing it for them or him?
Amen.
Amen. Oh, my. So, Brother Rudy, I don't like that. That's all right. That's all right. The door's locked, and I've got a bodyguard. Where's my bodyguard? I had one. He didn't come tonight. My goodness, must have knew I was going to preach. Listen, we're here to do His bidding. We've only got a short time. I've got to hurry. There's so much needs to be said. The Bible says here to be sober. We're to be of sound mind. We're to have a clarity of mind, a clarity of speech. We're not to be ruled by our emotions. It is not, as it was said earlier, about us. It's about Him, church.
Amen.
It's not about the pastor. God can do His work without the pastor. God can do His work without you. You need Him more than He needs you.
Amen, brother.
Peter said, listen, in the light of the last days, you need, as children of God, you should glorify God through prayer. Romans 12:3, you don't have to turn there, but I want to read it. It says this, "For through the grace given to me, I say to every man among you not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think so as to have sound judgment."
Amen.
As God has allotted to each a measure of our faith. You know, it's, I don't have a problem of thinking too less of me. I don't. I asked Donna coming over here, I said, I hit my head there, and I said, did I mess my hair up? I did, I asked her that. I think too highly of myself. And so do you. Have all these books and think self-help books, and they say, well, you just don't think good enough of yourself. Church, our problem is we think too much of ourselves.
Amen.
It's not about I, it's about Him.
Amen.
Don't think highly of yourself. The Bible says to be sober. But also in verses 8 and 9, the Bible says here, "And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sin. Use hospitality one to another without grudging." You and I, children of God, we should glorify the Lord with our prayer. Amen.
Amen.
We should glorify God with our love. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Remember what 1 Corinthians 13 says? You can have all faith. And if you don't have charity, you're nothing.
That's right.
You can have all the gifts of the Spirit, every one of them. Speak with tongues, do everything. You don't have charity, you're nothing.
Amen.
You're a tinkling sound. You're an empty bell. That's all you are. One day I put my name there. I want you to do that sometime. 1 Corinthians 13, just turn over there, just you and the Lord, and put your name where the word charity is, because it's exactly what you should do. Charity never puffs itself up. Charity never behaves itself unseemly.
Amen.
Rudy never gets in pride. Rudy never behaves himself unseemly. Always carries himself the right way, on and on and on. Read 1 Corinthians 13. You'll find out your duty as love is concerned.
Amen.
Oh my goodness, you want to be humbled? Put your name there. We think we're good Christians, but are we, church? See, revival is saying, listen, God, I'm not where I need to be. Oh God, I'll do anything to get where I need to be, that I might win my people to the Lord, that I might fulfill my purpose, that I might reach my potential for you, God. Oh my goodness. My goodness. Love. You know, love has more sweat with it than it does sweetness. See, I can love some of you. Some of you are pretty good people. I like you because you're like me. But some of you, you're just hard to love. Amen? Yeah, you are. Just got that demeanor about you, that personality about you. It just strikes me the wrong way. There's something about you I don't like. I know you've got a pastor that to some of you he's tall, to some of you he's short, to some of you he has hair, to some of you he doesn't, to some of you he's fat, to some of you he's skinny. To some of you it doesn't matter what he does or what he says, he'll never please you. Yeah.
Bless his heart, Lord.
Yeah. Every church I pastored, I've always had somebody that kept me straight. In other words, I had somebody that didn't like me. And they told me.
Bless his heart, Lord.
Brother, that'll grow you. You know it?
It will.
Because God said to love him, and He said to love your enemy. Well, I love him. I don't like him, though. You know, somebody said this, it says that if we want to do something, we're going to do it. If we don't want to do it, we'll find excuses. And that's so true. My brother told me when I was a young boy, I made an excuse about not doing something. He said, Rudy, every excuse is a lie. And I disagreed then, but I agree with him now. It is.
Bless his heart, Lord.
You're to love, church. And love is hard. You know what he told the church? The labor of love.
Amen. Amen.
1 Thessalonians, I appreciate Paul said your labor of love. Oh, it's hard for me to love some of you. When you don't tell me I do good, or you don't tell me I preach right, or you don't like what I say, or you kind of milt and you don't shake my hand when you go out, you're not going to do that tonight, are you? That hurts my feelings.
Bless him, Lord.
We're called to love each other, church.
Yeah. Amen.
And if you're milt at another brother or sister, you're in sin. You're in sin.
Amen.
It's wrong. It does not bring glory to God.
That's right.
And it causes hurt to the body of Christ. Amen. You're not going to like everything the preacher says. If you like everything he says, you need to kick him out because he's not preaching the Word of God. Amen? Amen. I'm not here to make you feel good. I'm not. I want you to repent. In sackcloth and ashes. Amen? Because I've had to before I preach this sermon. It's hard to preach something that you're doing. So you got to repent. Bible said if you got something and you're at the altar and you're asking God for something, he said, hey, leave your prayer there, your gift there, and you go make it right with your brother. Amen. And then you come back and you make it right with me.
Amen. Amen.
Say, I love you, Brother Rudy.
I love you, Rudy.
The Bible says here that you and I, as children of God, in these verses, that we're to love each other. We're to have fervent charity. You know what the fervent charity means? It means reaching forward, straining with every ounce of strength that you got to love.
Amen.
That is to characterize us, church, in the last days. Peter's saying, listen, I know what happens when trial comes. I know what happens when persecution comes. He said, you're going to fall apart. You're going to turn against each other. That's a sign of the time, by the way.
Amen.
Beloved, as children of God, we can't turn from each other. We've got to turn to each other and lift each other up. Listen, times are hard. In the last days, perilous times shall come, for men should be lovers of themselves more than lovers of God.
Amen.
Many of them are going to have a form of godliness, but don't you be that way, church. You be the real thing.
Amen.
You be the real thing. Only got a few days left. I can make it when I see light at the end of the tunnel. And I see light at the end of the tunnel, church. He's coming, amen. Praise the Lord. He's coming. I'm going to see Him. You need to love each other. Love each other. Love each other. Look to your neighbor. Look to that husband or that wife and say, I love you. Can you? Come on now. Look to that one next to you and say, I love you in the Lord. I love you. 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 And when somebody says something bad that hurts your feelings, you say, I love you. I love you. I love you. And you love them. And you say, I forgive you. You don't have to ask me. You don't have to do anything. I'm going to do it. It's on my part. I'll take the load. I forgive you. Say, Brother Rudy, I'm taking them off the hook. No, you're not. You're putting them on God's hook. He's got a bigger hook, better hook than you, I'll assure you. Let it go.
Amen.
Let it go.
Amen.
That is what we need to do as children of God. We need to love. The Bible says for you and I to love with a fervent love, a love that reaches beyond ourselves, a love of God that, listen, doesn't see anything, the one we love. But we love them.
Amen.
Because God loved us that way.
Sure.
Oh, I've got to hurry. I know. I've got 16 more points and we'll cover most of them. Listen, many things that we've got to do. As children of God, we need to understand that. Again, then it goes, it says that love shall cover the multitude of sins. Love says, I forgive.
Amen.
No matter what you do to me, no matter what you do against me, no matter how you hurt mine or my children. Boy, if you want to hurt somebody, you do something to their children. Amen. My goodness, church. We're raising them in the things of the Lord.
Amen.
You need help, Mama. You need help, Daddy.
Amen.
And that's what the church is for. And we say, I forgive. It covers the multitude of sins. But I want you to notice, it goes on to say, use hospitality one to another without grudging. You know what the word grudging is? Complaining. You know what the root word for hospitality is? Hospital. You know what you are? You're a hospital. Hospital, you don't go into hospitals to get sick. You go to get well.
Amen.
Say with me, I'm a hospital. And say it like you mean it. I'm a hospital. I'm a hospital. If I'm a hospital, I don't care what this man does to me. I'm here to make you well, brother. What can I do to help you?
How much time you got?
Oh, brother, got all night if you need it. They ain't no hurry. Brother, that's what I'm here for. I'm here to love you. I'm here to help you. I'm your servant. I want to be your healer. Now, I know you're not perfect. I know you're not going to be good to me all the time. You don't have to be. I want you to know that. You don't have to have a pretense. You don't have to put something up in front of me and be something you're not. You can just be you, brother.
Amen.
That's all that matters. And I'm going to be me. Is that okay?
Amen.
Because I got stuff that I'm dealing with, and I need you to be a hospital for me. And sir, I need you to be a hospital for me. I got problems. I tell you can talk to my wife. She can tell you all about them. Brother, I need you to be a hospital for me, would you? Can I come anytime? Can you be the one to uplift me and help me and love me? Brother, no matter what, because sometimes I'm not lovable. Is it okay? You won't turn against me, will you? You won't go down to this neighbor here and, now, I don't want you to tell him about me. I want you to tell him about me, okay? You won't go to him, will you? You better know. You won't, will you? Church, we're a hospital to each other. I'm serious. I'm as serious as I can be. That's what you are. That's what I am. You use hospitality one to another without grudging, without complaining, without requiring something back. Amen. You love them. Yeah. Amen. Oh my goodness. Church, you got people going here and there. They follow men. They follow stuff. They try to follow the Spirit. You be what God wants you to be at this church. You love this church. You love these people. And if you're from another church tonight, you take this home and you by prayer, you look to God and say, God, how would you have me uplift my people? How would you have me to be a hospital to them? That's what we are. The next time you get miffed, you need to understand something. You can't do nothing for God and be miffed. Amen. You can't do nothing for God and hold unforgiveness in your heart. And I hear people all the time, they'll say, well, Brother Rudy, I remember how it used to be. Listen, you are not where it used to be. You're now. God put you here for such a time as this. That's why you're here, to be a hospital. But I've got to hurry because you're already tired. Don't say amen. I won't preach this long tomorrow night, maybe. Notice the last part, verse 10 and 11. I want you to notice what God says here, and we're finishing. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. In other words, because you've received from Him things that you did not deserve, God's riches at Christ's expense, you didn't pay for it, you didn't do nothing for it. As you received it freely, so give freely. Amen. Then verse 11 says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified. Listen, God is glorified when we take the authority in prayer. God is glorified when we take the authority of love and we place it in our lives and we make ourselves do it the way God wants us to do it. And then it says that you and I are to glorify God by serving one another. And He breaks all of the gifts that God gives us. 1 Corinthians tells us that every person at the time of salvation was given at least one gift. Every person in this building is saved. You've been given a supernatural gift of God. You need to find out what it is, and you need to be exercising. That's exactly what Peter said to do in the last days. He put them in two broad areas. He put them in, and we read it, in the speaking gifts. That's what I'm doing tonight. And in the ministering gifts. The helping gifts, the encouraging gifts, those that minister. He put them into two categories and He said, listen, you've been given a speaking gift or a serving gift or you've been given both. You need to be exercising them to the glory of God in the church that God has placed you. And by the way, He didn't place you to go to this church and that church and say, I'm just a minister to all. He gave you a local body to be faithful in and to serve the Lord in. Can I hear a hearty amen? Here is where you're to serve. Here is where you're to exercise your gift. God said, listen, Peter said, I want you to understand that in the last days you need to be exercising your gift or your gifts. And you need to be doing it to the glory of God. Listen, there's been times I've wanted to quit preaching, and I'm closing tonight. I closed for a while, though. I'm closing tonight. But I want to tell you, there's been times I wanted to run from the ministry. There's been times that I have been hurt to the core by what people have said or done. I know Brother Jeff has. Brother Tom, if he not, he will. But I want to tell you something, we'll be hurt to the core. But I'm not serving the Lord. I'm not exercising my gift because of you, what you say or don't say. I'm exercising my gift because it brings glory to God. And it doesn't matter if you brag on me. It doesn't matter if you tear me down. I found that a long time ago as a young preacher. I preached the message. I thought I'd done an awful good job. Man came back there and he said, Brother Rudy, wow, you took us to heaven today. And I said, yeah, I did, didn't I? Woo! I said that to myself, not him. You know, I'm humble. Amen. I won't say that to him, but listen, it wasn't 2 minutes later, an older lady that I respected highly come back and said, Brother Rudy, you missed it today, didn't you? I prayed for you, but she said, you continue. You're going to make a good preacher someday. Oh my God, I went from heaven down to hell. I said, oh my goodness, God knows how to take the pride away from you. Amen. If anything good you ever do, it will be because of Him, church.
Amen,
listen, if there's anybody gets saved under my ministry, it ain't me, it's not my preaching, it's not what I done, it's because of Him. Amen. It's Him, church. Listen, the Bible says the very best I can do in myself is filthy rags in the eyes of a righteous God. I can't do it. He can. When I live and move and have my being in Him, God is glorified. Church, glorify the Lord. Lift Him up in the gifting that God has done to you. Learn to say, I forgive. I love you. Oh, I love you, Lord. I've received. You know what the Christian life is? It's two things. It's number one, like this right here. Oh, just give me, Lord. I want all I can get from you. Amen, don't you? Oh, Lord, give me. But it's not just this right here. It's to get that you might give, church. Amen. That's the Christian life. It's receiving and it's giving. Give. And God will give back. Press down and running over, church. Try it sometime. Pray without ceasing. Have a labor of love that goes beyond yourself. And serve with every ounce of energy you got, church. Listen, uplift, encourage, love with all your heart. And God will help you reach your potential. And when you see Him, He's going to say, oh, enter in, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the glories of the Lord. Enter into an eternity with God, an eternity in the glory of heaven. Beloved, I look forward to that time, don't you? I'm going to do it, amen. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed, brother, as you stand.